And I wanted to mention that we're having the Calvary Servants Conference this coming Saturday. This is the last day to sign up. So there's a sign up in the hallway if you want to come join us. It's a free event. We're just going to have a great time at Calvary Chapel Bellevue. I'll give you all the details if you do sign up, when we're going to meet and all that. So sign up today if you want to. I wanted to mention that next week we're having baptisms. So if you want to get baptized, encourage you to come talk to me. We don't have a sign up for that, but just come talk to me, and we're going to have just a great time. So if you want to get baptized, there you go. And then also, Wednesday night, we have, of course, our services. We've been having just a great time in the Book of Revelation and youth group and all that that's been going on. So anyways, good times. So come out for that. All right, why don't we stand? I'll pray. We'll worship the Lord. Lord, Father God, we thank you so much that we can worship you today. What a privilege and honor it is to be with you. And we just invite your presence to come fill us, Lord, this morning. And we just again recognize how much we need you this morning. Bless our service in Jesus' name. Amen.
These are the days of Elijah.
Let's sing it.
These are the days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. And these are the days of your servant Moses, righteousness being restored. And though these are days of great trials, of famine and darkness and sword, still we are the voice in the desert crying, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Behold, he comes riding on the clouds, shining like the sun at the trumpet call. So lift your voice, it's a year of jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes.
These are the days of Ezekiel.
And these are the days of Ezekiel, the dry bones becoming as flesh. And these are the days of your servant David, rebuilding a temple of praise. And these are the days of the harvest, the fields are as white in the world. And these are the laborers in your vineyard, declaring the word of the Lord.
Behold, he comes riding on the clouds, shining like the sun at the trumpet call. So lift your voice, it's a year of jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes. There's no God like Jehovah. 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 There's no God like Jehovah.
There's no God like Jehovah. There's no God like Jehovah. There's no God like Jehovah.
There's no God like Jehovah. There's no God like Jehovah. There's no God like Jehovah. There's no God like Jehovah. There's no God like Jehovah. There's no God like Jehovah. There's no God like Jehovah. There's no God like Jehovah. Behold, he comes riding on the clouds, shining like the sun at the trumpet call. So lift your voice, it's a year of jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes. Behold, he comes riding on the clouds, shining like the sun at the trumpet call. So lift your voice, it's a year of jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes.
are your days, Lord. These are the last days. You are the everlasting God.
Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord.
Our God, you reign forever. Our hope, our strong deliverer. You are the everlasting God. Everlasting God, you do not faint, you won't grow weary. You're the defender of the weak, you comfort those in need, and you lift us up on wings like eagles.
Strength will rise.
Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord.
Our God, you reign forever. Our hope, a strong deliverer. You are the everlasting God, the everlasting God. You do not faint, you won't grow weary. You're the on wings like eagles.
Our
God, you reign forever. Our hope, our strong deliverer.
Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord.
Yes, Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon you. And that's what we do right now, Lord. Corporately, just all together, Lord, we just wait upon you, knowing that you are good, you are worthy, you do lift us up, Lord. We need that, Lord. We need to know that we are embraced by you, that we are undergirded, our lives, our very lives, our families, that you undergird us, you support us, you love us, you care for us. You do strengthen us, you protect us, you provide for us, Lord. All these things and so much more, all of the details of our lives, strength will rise as we wait upon you. Lord, let us wait upon you now, learn of you, worship you, for you are worthy. Amen. Amen. You guys could be seated if you like. You unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies till all my fears are gone. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. And I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. From my mother's womb, you have chosen me. Love has called my name. And I've been born again into your family. Your blood flows through my veins. And I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. And I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child. A child of God. You split the sea so I could walk right through it. My fears were drowned in perfect love. You rescued me so I could stand and sing. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. Lord, you tell us to be strong, to be courageous. You tell us not to fear. You tell us over and over in your word not to fear, because you know us, and you know that our propensity is to be fearful because there's so many things that we don't know. But Lord, help us to remember that we know you and that you hold everything under control. Lord, just even myself when I'm fearful, that I would remember that I belong to you And I don't need to be enslaved by fear. I can trust you. Thank you, Lord. Here, moving in our midst, I worship you, I worship you. You are here, working in this place, I worship you, I worship you. Sing that again. You are here, moving in our midst, I worship you, I worship you. You are here, working in this place, I worship you, I worship you.
Darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
You are here, touching every heart. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, healing every heart. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, turning life around. I worship you.
Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when You never stop working. You never stop. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop. You never stop working.
Let's stand together.
You never stop. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop. You never stop working. You never stop.
You're the
way maker. You never stop working.
Way maker.
Miracle worker. Promise keeper. Light in the darkness. My God. That is who you are. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God. That is who you are. That is who you are. That is who you are. That is who you are.
See it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. Never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. Never stop, you never stop working. You, Lord, you never stop working. You're always, always moving, always working for our good, for your glory, really, mostly for your glory. And we glorify you this morning. Amen. 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 Turn around and say hello to somebody around you. just do one more. I just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind. 'Cause I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus.
I just want to speak the name of Jesus till every dark addiction starts to break, declaring there is hope and there is freedom. I speak Jesus. 'Cause your name is power, your name is healing, your name is life. Break every strong, shine through the shadows, burn like a fire. I just want to speak the name of Jesus over fear and all anxiety, to every soul held captive by depression. I speak Jesus. 'Cause your name is power, your name is healing, your name is life. Break every stronghold, shine through the shadows, burn like a fire.
Your name is power.
Your name is power. Your name is healing. Your name is life. Break every stronghold. Shine through the shadows. Burn like a fire. Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus, for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus. Oh, shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus, for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus. Your name is power. Your name is healing. Your name is life. Break every strong. Shine through the shadows, burn like a fire. Your name is power, your name is healing, your name is life. Break every stronghold, shine through shadows, burn like a fire. just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind, because I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus.
Just want to speak the name.
Just want to speak the name of Jesus
over every heart,
over every heart and every mind.
Thank you, Lord.
'Cause I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus.
For your presence right now, Lord.
All right, you can be seated. I'm going to invite Igor up. Hey, before we get to the word today, I just want to quickly share. You know, Igor, his brother, you know, Igor's Russian, okay? I love Russian. You guys want to come on up? Yeah, Igor's Russian. No? Okay. Yeah, I love Russians.
Thank you.
The record.
Russians love
it. Here, you can use this microphone right here. But, you know, we're so grateful for Katya and Igor and the other Russian families that we have here. They're such a blessing to us. And we're thankful that you're here in America. You're a blessing. And, you know, Steve and Igor have been working on that steeple all, like, the last 3 days. So thank you, Steve. Stand up, Steve. Let's give Steve a hand, too. Thank you, guys. They're almost done. So thank you. But back to the Russian stuff. Your brother,
yes.
Younger brother.
My youngest brother.
Youngest brother there and his family, they have left Russia because they're calling up the military. Tell us yeah. about your brother and his wife.
Yeah, my brother, he's younger than me for 4 years, and I was babysitting him during all the childhood. I cannot go anywhere without him. And we were good friends. We played band. He was playing bass. I played drums together. My hometown is on the border with Ukraine, and we were living there, and my mom from Ukraine, my dad from Russia, and so we were traveling all the time. I was growing up in Ukraine, and now they are mobilizing Russians to go to have the fight with Ukrainians, with our family.
Yeah.
And my family packed their stuff, like my oldest brother with 4 kids and my other youngest brother with 4 kids, they pack all the stuff with my parents and they moved to Siberia. So, and my youngest brother, Max, he moved to Siberia first. He took his family to when he was there, the police and military police came and made my mom sign the documents mobilizing him to go to war. And they said if he will not show up, they will arrest him for 2 years, or they will take him and make him to go. Yeah. And that's why he packed his stuff and moved to Kazakhstan, and from Kazakhstan to Uzbekistan. And because Kazakhstan says, if you are running away from mobilization, we will arrest you and send you to Russia, back to Russia. So, and we want to take him here.
Now, real quick though, your sister-in-law, she also was getting mobilized too.
And she is a nurse, and if you are like nurse, you are mobilizing as well. So they have military IDs. So if you have military IDs, you are mobilized. And he was mobilized in the first week.
Yeah. So they left Russia this last week, mm-hmm. went to Kazakhstan. Kazakhstan said, hey, if you're Russian, you have 3 days, we're going to send you back home.
Yeah, if you have to re- register for first 3 days.
Yeah.
If you don't register, they can arrest you if you don't have registration official.
Yeah. So they traveled without a car through Kazakhstan.
Yeah.
Hitchhiking, essentially.
Yeah.
Getting rides and stuff. Made it to Uzbekistan.
Yes.
And you have some friends there from YWAM, and they're staying with them now. So they're safe in Uzbekistan for now, at least.
Yes.
So
for now, they can stay with our friends.
How many people know where Uzbekistan is? Okay, good. A few of you. So, but the plan is to bring your brother here.
Yes.
And yet, to get here is quite the task, right? Because they have to fly. They can't fly to Europe.
No.
They have to fly to Turkey or Saudi Arabia, and then they can't fly straight to here. They have to fly to Mexico, and then from Mexico, they have to try to cross the border.
Yes.
Correct.
Yes.
And so, to make a really long story short, we are standing with Igor and his brother, and we want to give you an opportunity to, if you want to help, you know, Igor's brother Max and his wife Vika. Sorry, get here. We just want to set up a special little fund. If you want to help with that, we just want to invite the church to do that. And we are so grateful. You know, when Katya and Igor came here, they came with nothing too. I mean, they had to leave all their things behind and trusted the Lord that He was bringing them here and to Skagit Valley. And we're so grateful for that. So grateful for you for here. So let's pray right now. And then, do you have anything else to share or not?
I don't.
Okay. All right. Yeah, and they're going to cross the border and claim asylum legally. And so we'll do that. Or non-legally. You can just come. No, I don't know.
Because it's the only kind of long-term way we see. We don't have, I don't know where they can go else from Russia. So I'm here. It's the only family outside of Russia. So and we have few of our relatives here in the valley. So it's the only good way to come for long-term or for short-term.
Yeah.
You know, to leave when it will be over there.
Yeah. So, just let us know. Come talk to me, or you can put something in the Agape box if you want to help.
This is Maxim, my brother's name, Maxim, and his wife, Vika, his son, Miron, and Emilia, their daughter, youngest daughter. So if you have 4 kids, you are kind of free of mobilization. They will not take you to the war. So if you have like less than 4 kids, they will take you, and they will government will take care of your kids.
Yeah. They also have some friends, Vlad and Vika in Georgia, escaped to Georgia, and they're there safe now, but we are praying for them too. So
It's all of my friends, they are kind of don't know what to do. Somebody stay and then like what to do, where to go, what, like, nobody wants to fight, nobody, I don't know. Oh, I know one guy who went and he said, I want to go, the only one guy.
Yeah.
Do you need me? He came by himself.
Yeah. So. Let's pray. Lord, we just thank you for Igor, Katya, Mario, Lord, what a blessing they are to our fellowship. And we are so grateful they're here. We pray for Max and Vika and their family, just wherever they are even right now, Lord. We just lift them to you, Lord, and we pray for your will to be done, Lord. And if we as a church can help in any way, we want to, Lord. And so we first start by praying and asking you, Lord, to work on their behalf, Lord, and for your will to be done in their lives, Lord. And so we pray for that, and we pray for their friends Vlad and Vika in Georgia also. And others too, Lord. This whole situation is just so crazy. And so we just call upon you and ask you to work a mighty, mighty work, Lord. And we thank you again in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, thank you.
Thank you, Kirk.
All right, let's open our Bibles to Mark chapter 2. And I just encourage you to keep praying, you know, for them and just a lot going on. So Mark chapter 2. Well, if you didn't get a chance last week to listen to Patrick Bever share on as he started Mark chapter 2, I just encourage you to go to our YouTube site or to go online and listen to it. It's a powerful message by Patrick, but we're going to continue where we left off last week, and let me just pray one more time. Lord, as we open up your word, we just call upon you, ask you, Lord, to speak to us. I thank you for each and every person here, Lord. Thank you for this beautiful day you've created. We just ask, Lord, that you would touch hearts and speak to us in a mighty and powerful way. In Jesus' name, amen. You know, Jesus' ministry has began here in Mark chapter 2, and he's been using this little town of Capernaum as really a home base. And he's called some of his disciples. We've seen he's called Peter, Andrew, James, and John. We've seen he's cast out demons. He's healed sick people. We learned last week of, you know, the four friends that Jesus forgave, you know, this paraplegic, forgave this man's sin, and then he heals him. And everybody's amazed at what Jesus was doing. Now, Jesus started picking his team, you know, the disciples that he was going to have follow him. And live with him and teach them. And, you know, if you were trying to generate some influence, if you were to create a following, establish leadership, these were not the sort of guys necessarily that you would pick, to be honest. I mean, these guys, he didn't choose those disciples. They didn't have any influence, really. They had no power. They were just regular guys. Many were fishermen. And yet, they became men who turned the world upside down. Today, we're going to look at another man who Jesus called, Matthew. But before we get to Matthew, I just want to point out one important thought. And I'm going to start in verse 13 of Mark chapter 2. And it says, "Then he went out again by the sea, and all the multitude came to him, and he taught them." He taught them. You know, you can kind of picture this. He's by the Sea of Galilee there. Many people were coming to him, and he began to teach. Jesus, his ministry, the focus of his ministry was to teach. If you just even go back in Mark chapter 1, verse 38, Jesus himself said, "For this purpose I have come, to teach." Jesus, I think he knew how to stay really focused on this. We see him teaching a lot. We see him preaching. In John chapter, or in Mark chapter 1, verse 4, we see John was preaching the repentance of and remission of sins. We see in verse 7 he preached. In Mark chapter 1, verse 14, Jesus came to Galilee preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God. In Mark chapter 1, verse 21, he went to the synagogue and taught. He was teaching them. In Mark chapter 1, verse 38, he said, "Let us go to the next towns that he can preach." In Mark chapter 1, verse 39, he was preaching in the synagogues. He preached the word to them in Mark chapter 2, verse 2. We see just in these few verses, these few chapters, that teaching and preaching are important to God. But also, we might say learning and growing are important to him too. You know, Jesus was preaching, he was teaching people that they would grow, that they would learn, that they would grow in knowledge of God's word. You know, not only was Jesus, you know, teaching the crowds, but also he was teaching the disciples, he was growing them, he was teaching them how they would eventually go out and teach. They would eventually go out and preach. And so as Jesus called this multitude to himself, as we see here in verse 12, you know, the words here is they kept on gathering. They didn't stop. They just kept on coming to him. And that meant he just kept on teaching them. Well, you know, we see Jesus often speaking in the synagogues. We see him often teaching in houses, in towns, on the countryside, on hillsides. We see him sometimes teaching from a boat on the sea. He taught every time he had an opportunity. You get the picture here. He taught often. He really never stopped teaching. Now, sometimes we focus on the miracles and these things, the supernatural, but we have to understand that most of his ministry was teaching, was explaining the word of God, was preaching to them. The majority of his time, this is what he did. So with that in mind, let's look at Matthew, or Levi as he's called in the Bible, is another person that he's called. Verse 14, it continues and it says, as he passed by, he saw Levi, the son of Alphaeus, sitting at the tax office, and he said to him, follow me. So he arose and followed him. Now we know that Levi's name was also Matthew, and Levi would have heard Jesus teaching many times. This wasn't the first time that they met. He was a local businessman, we might say. You know, they would have to pay taxes to him. He had a booth, and so they would have known who this who Levi was, Matthew here. And to leave this tax booth would have cost him a lot. Tax collectors in Jesus' day were very rich. You know, I picture Jesus, you know, teaching and looking over at Matthew in the corner of his eye, making sure Matthew is paying attention. And I also see Matthew, or Levi, trying his best to kind of look disinterested. But something wonderful took place in his heart, in his life. And it seemed maybe strange at first. It happens to anybody who hears the word of God. It begins to really hit home in your heart. Is the true words, these living words in this Bible here, and your heart might start racing a little, and it's God really speaking to you. And I know many in this room have experienced this before, and that's exactly, I think, how Levi here, he experienced this. As Jesus taught, there's something in his heart that started changing. And maybe it didn't happen overnight. I mean, he had a lot to lose. He was a very wealthy man. But just at the right time, notice here, Jesus simply approached him and said, follow me. Follow me. And his heart had been prepared, I think, for that very, very moment. For the first time in his life, all the money, it meant nothing to him. All the riches, he just, as he looked into Jesus' eyes, and he heard his voice calling, Levi or Matthew here suddenly became one of Jesus' men. He was despised by men, but loved by God. I mean, such men, tax collectors, they weren't known for their honesty, right? They were looked down upon. They were considered kind of the scum of society, in a sense, because tax collectors, they would collect the taxes, both from their fellow citizens, but as well as merchants that were passing through. And he put Capernaum was really a port there on the Sea of Galilee that many would travel through this area, and they would take a commission. You know, that on the taxes, and most of them would overcharge, and they would keep the profits. And they were hated for this cheating, but also they were hated because they were supporting Rome. And so there's this kind of dual thing that why they were hated. They often were excommunicated from the synagogue. They were shamed by their friends and family because of this profession. And so everyone would have known who Levi was here. They would have known that's Levi, the tax collector. And yet, to Levi's credit, when he heard the call of God, do you notice it says he dropped everything and followed him? In many ways, this calling to follow Jesus was harder for Levi compared maybe to the other disciples. You know, Jesus goes to this tax collecting office. We can kind of picture it. And here's what he says. He says, you know, he didn't say, give me 2 weeks. Let me take care of business here. Let me give my 2 week notice. Let me finish up this project. Let me save up some money. No, it says he arose and followed him. It says he arose, again, verse 14, the end of it. So he arose and followed him. Actually, in Luke's gospel, it tells us in chapter 5, verse 28, he adds this remark. He says he left all. He left all, arose, and followed. He left all. You know, it's been said that the freest people are those who have learned to leave things behind. You know, I think about Hebrews chapter 12, where it says, let us lay aside every weight. I mean, the scriptures tell us that we as Christians, we are to lay aside the weight. We are to lay aside the sin that so easily ensnares us. We are to lay these things to the side. There's something sometimes in our life that I think the Lord often, he's maybe telling us to leave aside, to lay it aside, to let it go. Maybe in your life this morning, God is you know, we hold on to things, though, don't we? And when we hold on to things, we don't experience all that the Lord has for us when we hold tightly these things of this world. Maybe this morning, the Lord is asking you to leave something behind, to lay something aside, to rise up like Levi here, and follow the Lord in a deeper way. I think sometimes he calls us to do this, to be more committed. I know that sometimes as a pastor, I believe the Lord calls pastors to give up certain things, you know, to lay aside certain things that I believe that are sometimes hard. But as Christians too, you know, we might have the freedom to do certain things, but the Lord might call us to lay this aside, to put this to aside, to do certain things, to rise up like Levi here and to go higher with the Lord, to go deeper in our walk. That's what the Lord wants often. I've watched many people who have been limited in ministry or maybe even held back, or we might even say weighed down in their Christianity because they were not willing to leave something behind. They just wanted to hold on to this thing, and it can be a secret sin. It can be a little compromise, these little gray areas that we have. So for others, it can be bitterness. It can be an attitude that they're not willing to let go of. Some people fear. Because of fear, they're not willing to trust, or just even that lack of trust. You know, some people are just willing to serve as long as it doesn't interrupt my life, right? I'm willing to follow you, Lord, as long as I have nothing is interrupted here. But other people, they just don't want to give up things. And it causes them not to truly rise up and follow, like we see in this example here. What Matthew did is not only did he follow, but then he holds a banquet for Jesus. I love this. Look at verse 15. Well, he followed me, so he rose and followed him. And then it says in verse 15, it says, now it happened as he was dining in Levi's house that many tax collectors and sinners also sat together with Jesus and his disciples, for there were many and they followed him. You know, Levi here, he couldn't wait to run out and tell all of his friends about Jesus. And, you know, the change that happened in his own heart was so significant that he wanted to share this with his friends. And he wanted them to meet the man that changed his life. This was a party that he threw. And now no self-respecting Jew would have ever attended, but God did. Jesus did. And Levi, you kind of get the sense that he's excited about this new life, that he throws this party, invites all of his friends. Again, tax collectors, they had lots of money. And they probably loved to throw parties, and their only friends were other tax collectors, were other sinners, as the Bible says. But Levi, Matthew here, he wants everybody to get saved. He wants everybody to hear the truth. And so Jesus is planted right in the middle here. And what a sight this would have been. You know, Jesus in this room, in this food and this banquet that is being thrown. Now, it's in the Jewish culture, it was very significant to share a meal together, because in their thought is, if you had a loaf of bread and you broke that bread and you were eating of the same bread, you're in a sense joining yourself with them. You're creating this bond with them as you are eating the same food. And so to eat with them implied a level of friendship. And so I think, many of the Pharisees, many of the said, they wouldn't have liked this, right? I think of our day and age in which we live is, I think sometimes as Christians, we need to be guilty like Jesus of eating with tax collectors and sinners, right? Now I say this because the Bible also says bad company corrupts good morals in 1 Corinthians. And so some think, well, it's okay, to hang out with my old beer drinking buddies or whatever it is, but the question always comes is, who's influencing who, right? And so we have to be careful, because we want to influence others for Christ and not the other way around. But see, Jesus, he was willing to associate with all, even the scum of society. And yet he did not relate to everyone on the same level. He didn't relate to them on the same level. He saw people as either believers or unbelievers. And his interaction with believers is he fellowshipped with them. And his interaction with unbelievers is he shared the truth, evangelism, we might say. You know, he shared the gospel, the truth with them. See, we need to see, I think, people as Jesus did. The same as Jesus did. Your relationship to unbelievers, we are to be ambassadors for Christ. We are to show the love of Christ, the grace of Christ, the truth. And with believers, we fellowship, you know. We encourage each other and so on and so forth. Well, for sure the critics are going to show up here. Look at verse 16. We start seeing this opposition, as I mentioned. It says, then the scribes and the Pharisees saw him eating with the tax collectors and sinners, and they said to his disciples, how is it that he eats and drinks with tax collectors and sinners? Now, at this stage in Jesus' ministry, the religious leaders, they wouldn't have known what to make of him. And they're still trying to figure this thing out. And now it's obvious that Jesus, in a sense, he's almost going out of his way to associate with these outcasts of society. And Jesus clearly didn't fit in with their ideas and their religious things, you know. His message, his ministry, was perplexing to them. And the Jewish leaders believed that they were doing the right thing by coming against him. I mean, you know, we learn later on of Saul of Tarsus, later on to be called Paul, and these men, they were zealous. They thought they were serving God the way they had been taught. And suddenly there's this new man on the scene, Jesus, doing these miracles, speaking about the kingdom of God, that he actually knew God, that was connected to God. And there was men, there was Pharisees, that, like Nicodemus. There was guys like Joseph of Arimathea, who later on would come to Christ after the resurrection. But these guys were listening. Well, I love how Jesus responded here. Look at verse 17. It says, when he heard it, he said to them, the scribes and the Pharisees here, he said, Those who are well have no need of a physician, but those who are sick. I did not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. The scribes and the Pharisees, they saw Levi and his friends as condemned sinners. But Jesus saw them as what? Spiritually sick patients who needed the help of a physician. Reminds me of the fact that although Jesus hated sin, he hated sin. He came to die for sin. He loved the sinner. Think for a moment, someone you know who, you think this guy is a sinner. If you look up heathen in the dictionary, his picture's next to it. Know this, that Jesus hates their sin, but he loves the sinner. He died for the sinner, and he wants to save the sinner. Guys, the church, we are to be a hospital for healing, for hurting people. And the great physician, Jesus, came to heal the sick. Those who are unrighteous, those who are bound up in their sin. Now, if you're not a sinner, then Jesus did not come for you. But we're all sick in sin, aren't we? The scribes and the Pharisees, see, this is their problem. They could not see their own sin. They couldn't see it. Guys, people go to the doctor when they're sick, right? I mean, I get it. We do, like, welfare checkups or, things like this. But until a person sees their sin and wants it removed, that, it's not, they're not going to come to Jesus, because we all have to see our sin. And Jesus is the physician. But this doctor not only diagnoses us perfectly, like we looked at the paralytic last week, he also cures completely. He cures our sin. He died in our place. But even better, he diagnoses you, he wants to heal us, and he's also a doctor who pays the bill. That's the kind of healthcare we need in this country, right? See, he came for those of us who know we need help. That's why he came for us. Those of us who recognize we need help. I can't do this. But if you don't need any help, what can he do? Now, Jesus, I don't think he looks at us as rejects or outcast, but just that we're sick. We're sick in our sin. And he's still looking for people who know they're not well. He's still doing that. But you have to come to the point where you recognize that you're not well. Some of you might have a doctor friend or a nurse friend. We have nurses here, or maybe a physician's assistant. I know Lisa's best friend and cousin, her husband, he was a contractor, built these houses, but in 2007 when the housing market crashed, he decided he's going to become a physician's assistant. And so he did. We're really proud of him. And it's like sometimes when you have questions and you have a friend like that, you want to ask them before you actually go to the doctor, And so how many of you guys do that? You have a friend, you ask them, right? But you don't want to bother them when you're feeling fine. You only want to bug them when something's wrong. And that's the message I think Jesus is communicating. The difference between religion and relationship. Religion teaches us that when we're sick, we only need to do some ritual thing and then all is forgiven. And the problem that leads to that conclusion is that we don't think we're really sick in the first place. But relationship, it really demands that we come to that object of the relationship and we're honest. If you think about it, we can't keep secrets with God. He knows everything. We can't pretend we're okay or our sins are somehow magically wiped away. I went to church, or I got baptized, or I participated in some mass. Many think, well, I did this thing, now I'm good for a while. But a relationship with the Lord is actually recognizing our sin, being sorry for it, and then based on grace of God that He has offered us, asking Him to forgive us, asking Him to restore us, being grateful for it. See, that's a relationship. That's the relationship that we have with the Lord. In religion, there's a whole lot of people that are sick, and they don't know they're sick. Guys, religion keeps people away from Jesus instead of drawing them to Him. And in the end, that kills. And I think that's the point that Jesus is making to the religious leaders, that they needed to be honest with their sin. They needed to be honest with it. They needed to come to God on the basis of grace and mercy and righteousness instead of coming to God on the basis of their works and their merit and their appearance. Because they appeared to be great. I mean, they appeared that they were perfect, in a sense. But Jesus, He came looking for sick people who knew they were sick. And these guys here clearly didn't get to the point. Now, we know that Matthew is given a new name. Levi means joined. It comes from the tribe of Levi, the Levites, right? The name, Levi is associated to his heritage. It's a name that, the Levites, they served in the temple. They worshiped God. The Levites, they would, bring people to God. And Levi, I think, spoke of, this joining together. But somewhere along the line, Levi became known as Matthew. And Matthew, many of you know, means gift of God, right? And so the Lord was, I think, in a sense, giving him this new start. This former outcast now is a gift of God. Awesome. And that's what the Lord does. He can take a life that's, Levi, he was joined to the wrong things, the tax collecting, and he can make us a gift of God. Now, it's interesting, we don't know a single word, there's not a single word of recorded that Matthew spoke. But, he wrote a lot. And he knew how to write. And because of the gospel of Matthew, countless of millions of people have been blessed because of his gospel. I think that this morning, I think Jesus, he extends the same offer that he offered to Levi, that we read about this morning, to us. I think about the word in Revelation 3:20 where it says, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come to him and dine with him and he with me." I mean, that's the door. He knocks on our hearts. And he knocked on the door of Matthew's heart with the words, "Follow me, follow me." And maybe he's knocking on your heart this morning. I mean, Jesus, listen, he was a friend of sinners. I mean, Jesus was the physician that he came to heal the sick from their sin. And we can't be like the Pharisees where they saw themselves as being acceptable to God. But they weren't. In reality, everyone at this party except for Jesus was a sinner. And one of the problems with the Pharisees was they didn't see their own sin. They just couldn't. Because sinners knew they needed help, and Jesus was there to help them. Thank the Lord, huh? I just think this morning, I'm running out of time, but, I think if you're a Christian, do you ever hang out with sinners? We're all sinners, right? But I think a sad thing happens sometimes as we mature in the Lord. We stop, all of our friends are Christian, And I think that we stop hanging out with, you know, some people. And again, we have to be careful, you know, that we don't, you know, we don't want to be drawn away from the Lord. But I think the Lord might have us also just, when was the last time we shared Jesus with someone? You know, that he came to save sinners. I mean, Jesus isn't at Levi's house because he had a great meal to serve. You know, he isn't there because he wanted to hear the latest dirty joke. He came there to bring sinners to God. That's why he threw this party. And there are all kinds of people in this world that we might find unacceptable. You know, but disciples, they wanted to run off the children. And Jesus says, no, bring the children to me. The woman at the well was an outcast, right? By her own fellow Samaritans. And Jesus says, you know, hey, I have living water I can give you. And Jesus sought to spend time with her and others. And I guess I would just encourage us this morning to take time to share with someone in your life. And pray for an open door to share Jesus, because that's what he did, right? Let's pray. Lord, thank you for this time. We thank you for these few verses, Lord, and how powerful they are. Lord, how you changed this one man's life forever. Lord, Lord, maybe had it made, Lord, by all the world's standards, Lord, but there was something wrong, and he ended up following you, and we're so grateful for that, Lord. We're so grateful not only that, but that he shared with his friends and his and those he worked with. And Lord, I look forward to someday meeting him. So Lord, help us, be with us, Lord. Speak to us as we go our separate ways this morning. We thank you, Lord, that you came for sinners like us. And we're thankful, Lord, that church is a hospital, Lord, and you're the doctor. So Lord, draw us near to you. Speak to our hearts in Jesus' name. Amen.